Okay, so today we start with the topic that is kinetics. Now, in this chapter, when you talk about kinetics, we will be talking about how to measure the rate of reaction. That would be the first thing you will understand. Measure the rate of reaction. Then, once you know how to measure the rate of the reaction, you will understand why reactions are of different speed, why reactions are of different speed or rate. And the third thing is, why do they actually occur? Why do the reactions take place? So we will understand why the reaction takes place and why are they of different rate once you understand the measuring of the rate of the reaction. Now, before you go on to understand the measuring of the rate of the reaction, we should first understand what we mean by rate of reaction. Now, when you say rate of reaction, if it was a physics, you would have said rate means speed, and speed means distance over time. Now, the problem is in the reaction, everything is being done in the test tube. So, you cannot say what is the distance over there because nothing is moving out of the test tube. So, over here, we already know when you talk about reaction, reaction means you're talking about reactants converting into products. So, when you say a reaction, it means reactants converting into products. Now, what happens in the reaction is the reactants amount decreases with time and the product increases with time. Increases with time. So for us, if we want to measure the rate of the reaction, if we want to measure in terms of physics like distance covered, so we will be talking about how much of the reactant has changed or how much of the product has changed. So this formula for physics, we will modify it for chemistry and we would say rate of reaction is equal to change in amount of, now this could be amount of either the reactant or you can say product, depending on what you are measuring, over the time taken for that change. Now, if you observe over here, I'm using the word amount. Now, what actually is the meaning of amount? Now, amount could mean you are measuring the moles. Amount could mean you are measuring the volume of any gas produced. Amount could mean that you are measuring the concentration of any solution. Amount could mean you are measuring the change in mass of any of the solid. Now, what you will measure that depends on what you measured, that depends on the reaction taking place. Means there are a variety of different methods to measure the change. What are you going to change? The variable you will use, that depends on the reaction. For example, if we were given this reaction, NaOH plus HCl. Now, NaOH is aqueous solution. HCl is an aqueous solution. Now, this will form NaCl aqueous. We already know that sodium chloride is a soluble salt, plus H2O, which is a liquid. Now, if you want to measure the change in volume, you cannot measure. Volume change cannot be measured over here. Volume change cannot be measured. The reason is no gas is being formed. Reason is no gas produced over here. So if there was any gas being produced, then you could have measured the amount of gas produced in a given time. So volume change is not an option over here. Same way for this reaction, mass change is also not an option. Mass change is not an option over here. When I say an option, it means you cannot measure or record the change in mass to know the rate of the reaction. Now the reason is, according to the law of conservation of mass, we know that the total mass of reactants will be equal to the total mass of products. So since nothing is escaping out, everything is in this test tube. Initially you had this thing, afterwards when the reaction is complete you have this thing. So everything is in the test tube, nothing is escaping out, and that's the reason why the total mass before and after remains constant. So again, the mass change is not an option over here, the volume change is not an option over here. So then what is the option? The option could be, you can measure change in electrical conductivity, change in electrical conductivity. You can measure the change in concentration of either the HCl or the NaOH. But these things we will be going into details at the grade 13 or the A2 level. So here what I have tried to explain to you is, by taking this example, is that which method you will use, that depends on the reaction which is given to you. For example, let's try to take another example. Let's try to take another example to help us understand this. Let's say I have taken another reaction, which is calcium carbonate plus HCl or H2SO4. Again, calcium carbonate is solid. This is aqueous. Now when this reaction takes place, it forms calcium chloride, which is aqueous, plus H2O liquid, and then you have a CO2 gas. Now here you have a gas being produced. So you have an option of change in volume. You can measure the change in volume. That's one option. This is a solid, so you can measure the change in mass. So right now at the AS level we will focus on only these two things: how to measure the change in volume or change in mass. So what we know is that if you want to measure the rate of reaction, if you want to measure the rate of reaction, we know it depends on the reaction given to you, but right now we will focus is, it could be measured in terms of volume change, or it could be measured in terms of mass change. So either way, there are other methods, but we are focusing only on this thing. So let's try to focus on in terms of the first thing, in terms of volume change. So let's focus on in terms of volume change. Again, I will have to take an example where a gas is being produced. So let's take the same reaction I had given you before. That was calcium chloride solid plus HCl aqueous gives you calcium chloride aqueous plus H2O liquid and carbon dioxide. So our focus would be how to collect this gas. This is your gas over here. So we will focus on how to collect this gas, and then we will also focus on how to set up this apparatus. So this would be the way you will set up the apparatus. You will have your reaction mixture over here. You will have your reaction mixture, that means the calcium carbonate and the HCl. Initially your syringe will be at a zero mark. Now as the carbon dioxide is produced, it will go over here, it will push this plunge outside, and you can measure the volume of the gas collected. So there are different ways also of collecting gas. One way is you can collect it over water, but let's focus on this thing. So over here what you will do is you will record the volume of carbon dioxide collected in a given time, and then use the formula. Use a formula, we will talk about this. That's the way to collect. Now remember, gas can also be collected. Collection of gas over water is not preferred. Now what could be the reason? So the collection of gas over water is not preferred. The reason is simple. So the arrangement is this way. This is the way you can arrange over water. It's also called as displacement by water, of water. So the reason is simple. The reason is that some of the gas may be dissolved in water. Some of the gas could be dissolved in water. So if some of the gas dissolve in water, then what would happen is there would be a volume inaccuracy, and as a result the rate would be inaccurate. So that's why whenever they say gas is being produced, you just use the gas syringe. As simple as that. So now once you have collected the gas, how to go over? So this can be explained in terms of a graph also. If you are collecting a gas, or we will talk about that later on, but let's talk about the next step, that is in terms of mass. Again, I would say take the same reaction. The reason being, we have calcium carbonate, which was solid. It was reacting with HCl, and it forms calcium chloride plus H2O plus CO2. So this we have done. Now we are focusing on this. So over here again, how do you set up the apparatus? Now this is the way you will set up the apparatus. Everything over here, your reaction mixtures would be over here. That means at this stage it is calcium carbonate and HCl. Now if you look over here, you are using a cotton wool over here. Now there are certain questions. Why are you using the cotton wool in your exams? So you are using the cotton wool to allow the gas to escape out, because whatever gas escapes out, that will be your decrease in mass. So you will do is you will initially mix the contents in the conical flask, and then record the initial volume, initial mass. Now what happens is as the reaction proceeds, carbon dioxide produced escapes out, and as a result what will happen is the mass decreases. So what you do is you record the decrease in mass over a time period. So over a time period what you do is, like for 10 minutes, 5 minutes, whatever, depending on how much time it takes for the reaction, you can record the decrease in mass. Now over here if you look this, they have put a cotton wool over here. Now why are you putting the cotton wool over here? Because you want the gas to escape out. Because the mass decrease will be proportional to the carbon dioxide escaping out. So whatever amount of carbon dioxide escapes out, the mass will keep on decreasing. Now there is a possibility they may ask you a question like if this was closed, let us say this was closed from here, then what will be the observation? Now if you close it, then what will be the observation? So now closed with a bung or whatever you want to close. Now what will happen is there will be no change in mass. Why there will be no change in the mass? Because carbon dioxide does not escape out. So everything is still inside the conical flask. So according to the law of conservation of mass, the total mass of the reactant remains equal to the total mass of the product. So that's the reason why there will be no change in the mass. So this is the reason why you have to put the cotton wool. Another important thing is they may ask you is why do we use a cotton wool? Why use cotton wool? Because even if you leave it, the carbon dioxide can still escape out. If you don't put the cotton wool on the mouth of the conical flask, the carbon dioxide may still escape out. So why are we using cotton wool? So the reason is simple. To avoid any liquid means it could be the HCl, it could be calcium chloride solution. So to avoid any liquid spilling out. Spilling out means that if it is hot, then it may burn the person who is doing an experiment. The other reason is the mass decrease will be more because you are losing some amount, extra amount in addition to the carbon dioxide escaping out. You are also losing some mass of the liquid. So your decrease in the mass would be more, which would mean there is an inaccuracy. So the next thing is, once you have done the measurement, now the next thing is plot graph. So we will plot the graph to calculate the rate of reaction either in terms of the volume. So we will plot the graph again in two terms, in terms of volume, in terms of volume of CO2 collected, and the other would be in terms of mass decrease or change in mass. So let's try to draw the graph in terms of the volume of carbon dioxide collected. Now remember, the rate will be always be directly proportional to the amount. Rate is directly proportional to the amount of reactants. Or you can simply say of substance. That means if that substance is more, the rate would be more. If the substance is less, now this substance, why I'm writing this substance? Because this could be in terms of the reactants, or this could be in terms of the product. That substance could be the reactants or the products. Whatever it is, the rate is proportional to the, you will go into more details in grade 13 about this thing. So the amount of the substance, if it is more, rate will be faster. If the amount is decreasing, the rate will be decreasing. Now if I plot a graph of the volume of CO2 collected over time, now initially the volume of carbon dioxide was zero. Now as the reaction proceeds, what happens is the volume of the carbon dioxide will keep on increasing. Then it slows down a little, and then it becomes constant. initially why it is more? Because there is more amount of the reactant, so the reactions is faster. Now as the reaction proceeds, so that's the reason why, if you will look over here, there are three regions or parts to this graph. The first part is very fast. It represents a fast reaction. Why it is fast? Because the amount of the reactants is the maximum, so the reaction is quick. Now after some time, the amount of the reactants have decreased. So what will happen is the rate will slow down, so the volume of carbon dioxide produced will also slow down. After a while, a time will come when the no more reactants are present. So if no more reactants are present, then what happens is the amount of the carbon dioxide is not going to increase. So this is the time when the reaction is finished. Reaction complete. So the third part is when the reaction is complete or stops. The reason why we are saying it is complete or stop, because no more carbon dioxide is being formed. So any graph in terms of product, this is volume of carbon dioxide, but actually it is representing the product. So any graph in terms of product for the rate of reaction will show the same shape. The reason is initially it will be less. As the time proceeds by, it will increase. Initially it will increase, then slows down, and after slowing down, the reaction would be complete. So this is, we need to know that this is the shape of the graph whenever they ask you. Now they may also ask you to calculate the rate at any given time period, and we will try to, let us say they ask us to calculate the rate of the reaction for time t1 and time t2. Between this time, what is the rate? Now the procedure will be, the procedure would be, you draw the perpendicular to the graph through the curve like this, and then over here, so let's label this as volume v1 at time t1, and then you have, and then at time t2, same way, you plot a perpendicular to the curve over here, and let's say it is over here. I think this line is not straight, so let's try to make it straight. So over here, at time t2, let's change this so that it doesn't meet the green line. This is time t2, so this is the volume at time t2. Let's label this volume as v2. So if you find the rate would be equal to v2 minus v1 over t2 minus t1. So the v2 minus v1 represents the change in volume, and t2 minus t1 represents the time taken. Now they could have asked us, now remember, this rate is the average rate. The reason is the rate keeps on changing depending on the amount of the substance. So if the amounts are changing, definitely the rate will also change. It will not remain the same. It's like, for example, you are traveling from this place to this place. Now what we are doing is you are calculating the distance covered. Let us say this was 100 kilometers you have covered in 2 hours. You have covered a distance of 100 kilometer in 2 hours. So you will say your speed was, or the rate was, 100 over 2, that is 50 kilometer per hour. but this is your average rate, because there or the speed. The reason is maybe there was an accident somewhere, so you slowed down on the road highway, or there was a petrol station, you stopped over there to take the petrol, so your speed was zero, or there was some traffic in front of you, so you slowed down, and in some cases the highway was clear, so you were moving more than 50 kilometer speed. What you are calculating is the average rate of the reaction. There is a possibility that we may be asked to calculate the instantaneous rate of the reaction. So there is a possibility, that we may be asked from the graph to calculate instantaneous rate of reaction. Now, what's the meaning of instantaneous? Now, when you say instantaneous, it means at any given time, Now, like for example, when you are driving, and this way is to calculate the average rate of the reaction, but suppose you want to figure out the speed at any given instant, what will you do? You will look at the speedometer. So the speedometer gives you the speed at that particular moment. It is 100 or 50 or 80 or 0, whatever is the speed that you can see at any given instant by looking at the speedometer. So let's say this is the graph for your, again, the rate of the reaction in terms of product. They want us to calculate the rate at any time. Let us say T1. You draw a perpendicular to a point and then draw the tangent. And over here now your rate will be equal to, the rate would be equal to change in product amount. Change in product over time taken, which is represented by delta product over the delta time. Now this means change. The delta sign represents the, so this will give you the rate of the reaction at any given instant, instantaneous rate. So this would be known as instantaneous rate, the way you are calculating from the, by drawing the tangent and so on. So this is with a when you want to figure out the speed rate at any given instant, while this is the graph to calculate the average rate of the reaction, this by this way. So this is the way to calculate the average rate of reaction, while this is a graph or the formula to calculate the instantaneous. So it just depends on how you are using the graph. Now we also know, I have already talked about that, that the graph can be the graph which you are drawing for the in terms of volume, it can be divided into three different parts: fast, slow, and so the steep gradient means the reaction is fast. When the gradient slows down or decreases, it's less slope, that means the reaction is slowing down, and when the gradient becomes zero, that means there is no change in the amount of the product, that means the reaction has stopped. So this was all about the volume of the product. Now the concept remains the same, the concept actually remains exactly the same. If you are talking in terms of mass, the measuring, the instantaneous, the average, everything remains the same in terms of mass change. The only thing that changes is the shape of the graph, or I would say the shape also remains the same. The only thing that actually changes is it flips. So if you are measuring the change in mass, remember this represents the reactants. So if you are measuring the amount of the reactants with time, then what happens is initially the amount of the reactants would be maximum, so the rate would be maximum, so the change in mass would be fast, more. Then So it will be initially fast, then it will slow down, and then it will become constant. It will go to some infinity to stop or meet the x-axis. Right now for us, you will study that in our maths. So over here, there are again three parts to this. This represents the fast reaction. That means the mass is decreasing quickly. Then this represents that the reaction has slowed down because the amount of the reactants have decreased. So the reaction is less, so the change in the mass is the less. And when it becomes constant to the x-axis or parallel to the, actually it will not be parallel, it will meet somewhere, we say that the reaction is complete. While rest of the thing where you talked about measuring the average rate or the average rate or the instantaneous rate, that everything remains same.